This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Would you stand with me, please, for our call to worship? How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. He bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray that your spirit will be guiding us now in all that we do, to your honor and glory, in Christ's name. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing hymn number 2, Come Thou Almighty King.
Sisters and brothers, we all fall short of the glory of God, yet when we confess our sins to God, God who is faithful, God who is just, and God who is forgiving, will cleanse us of all of those ways in which we inevitably fall down. So let us now confess our sins together using the responsive prayer and confession and our responsive assurance of pardon. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Grace to you and peace from God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're so glad to see each and every one of you here this 4th of July Sunday. We're grateful for your presence, and we're grateful for those of you who are visiting with us today that you have chosen to spend this holiday weekend here with us. We welcome you, and we want to invite you to participate with us as the pew pads come down the pew in front of you. If you would please register your presence with us, we would be most grateful to you doing that. We also want to welcome those of you who are worshiping with us by way of television. No, we are so glad, wherever you may be, that you are with us here today. And just know that your thoughts and concerns are with us as we lift up prayers to God this morning in worship. A few brief announcements for you this morning. First off, a thank you. We have had a wonderful week this past week in Vacation Bible School, and I dare not start listing all of those that I ought to, because I would be sure to leave somebody out. But an awful lot of work went into making last week a successful week in Vacation Bible School, and I want to thank, from the youth all the way up to all of you who worked and helped make that happen, thank you. And thank you too for those of you who brought your children and grandchildren to be with us last week. We're indeed appreciative. This coming week, on Saturday night, is family movie night on July the 9th at 5:30. It'll be in our Family Life Center, and look in your bulletin to get all of the details about it. But for $5 a family, you can't beat it, and we're going to have just a wonderful time of fellowship, and that will be in the Family Life Center. Also, during this month, we're going to be collecting food for the Soup Bowl ministry here in Tuscaloosa, and it is coming on the anniversary of Henry Lipsey's passing, who blessed this community for so long as head over our food bank. And so we're asking you, in his memory, if you would bring food, canned goods, and other non-perishables. There is a bin out in Warner Hall where you can put those items, and we would appreciate it very, very much. And remember, all the food will go to the Soup Bowl, and we're grateful for your help in that. I want to invite our children to come up now as we have word to the children with James.
kind of lonely up here, isn't it? All right. That's all right. I have a question for y'all, okay? If you are a child, I want you to stand up. So stand up if you're a child.
Oh, I lost my mic. All right. I'll just deal with that later. That's right. We're all. I'm a child. Am I a child? They look doubtful. I think I'm a child. I got to play with y'all all week this week at BBS. We got to play awesome games like Jesus Says instead of Simon Says, or High Tide, Low Tide instead of Red Light, Green Light. We got to play some awesome games. But I have a question for you. How many of y'all helped out with BBS? If you helped out with BBS, I want you to stand up too, because I think you're a child. Because you've got a child in there. You go. Look at all those people who helped out with BBS this week. Thank you. Stay standing. Okay, and we got some other special people here today. We've got some folks who work at Living River, our camp, who play with children all the time. So I want y'all to stand up too. That's right. They're good. Let's give them a round of applause too. If you're helping out with kids all the time, then we are all got some little kid in us, don't we? And it's exactly right, because the Bible says that we are all children of God. We are all, each one of us, children of God. I've got a little ornament here that they gave me to remind me that I am a child of God. We all are, because God made us all and created us all. So I'm going to ask the question again. If you are a child, I invite you to stand. We are all children of God, and we need to remember that and love one another exactly like that. Will you pray with me? Will you repeat after me? Dear God, thank you so much for all your children and for loving us so. We love you, God. Amen. And as you children of God remain standing, I invite you to greet one another in the name of Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as we open your word, we pray for your understanding, that you will enlighten our hearts and minds to enable us to walk with you as children of God. And we ask all of this in Christ's name. Amen. If you would, take your Bibles and turn with me to Romans chapter 8, and I will begin reading in verse 12. It's Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 12. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who were led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. And if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Paul is introducing a new metaphor, the word adoption, to help us understand what it means to live this life in the Spirit. God always pours out blessings on us and then calls us to live in the light of that blessing. His concern and love for us is always and constant and never wavers. And as his children, he wants us to understand fully the relationship that we have with our God. You'll notice in this passage it says that all those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. That word led has the idea behind it of being walking along with us. Think the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. The shepherd accompanies the sheep in the way that the Holy Spirit accompanies us through life. It's a definition of a Christian, that a Christian is a person who has been called and led by the Spirit of God and is living with the Spirit in their lives. As we are adopted into God's family, he wants us to live into the full realization of what that means in our day-to-day lives. Adoption is a wonderful thing. I will never forget a number of years ago, a pastor that I worked with, he and his wife were not able to have children and chose to adopt. And after several months, a little girl came as an opportunity for them to have a child. It was an open adoption. They knew the mother, and the mother knew them. And the day came when they were going to go to the adoption agency and do the final paperwork and everything, and they were going to bring that little girl home. He did not live too far from where I lived, and so on that day that I had circled on my calendar, that afternoon I walked over to their house, baby gift in hand, and went into the back through the back door, and I had not gotten both feet into the house when I knew something was wrong. The house was decorated for a celebration. All of the grandparents were there. Her grandparents had flown across the country to be there for this event. But it was like I had stepped into a funeral. And they told me that at the last minute, the mother got cold feet. And they came back home without a baby. Needless to say, I was stunned, as they were. I mean, to go for so many months in anticipation of this event, all of the family being there, and then for it not to happen, it was like walking into a funeral. As we sat and we talked with one another, the game plan was that they were going to go back to the adoption agency the next day and see if things could not be finalized. Before, on that day, all four of the grandparents had gone, other family had gathered at the house. And I spoke to my pastor friend and I said to him, I said, why don't you let me drive you to the agency tomorrow? And they looked at each other and they thought about it for a minute and said to me, he goes, I think that's probably a good idea. They did not want to go through what they had been through that day again. And so they told me the time, and so I came over and they got in my car with baby seat, and we drove to the adoption agency, and I went to the waiting room with the book to read, even though I couldn't concentrate on anything, worrying about what may or may not happen. And finally, after about 45 minutes, they came from the back of that office with baby in hand for us to go home. And so the three of them got in the back seat of my car, and I drove them back to the house. I will remember that day as a highlight of my ministry for the rest of my life. I can't tell you, after the anticipation and joy of that day coming, to have to go through the experience of it not happening, and then the roller coaster ride back up in anticipation that it could happen the next day, and then bringing that daughter home of theirs, was just an experience that I will never forget. A wonderful experience, a blessed time for me as well as for them. About 8 years after that, they had moved to the West Coast, and I was on a mission trip on the West Coast and was able to make plans to go by and visit with them while I was out there and to see this little girl who was, I think, 9 at the time, and to recall that day just blessed my life in so many ways. To know you're adopted, wanted, to know you've been drawn into a family is a blessed event. Then we have been adopted. We have been brought into the family of God. In Rome, at that time, adoption was really more about inheritance. A child or an adult would be adopted by a family for the purpose of receiving the inheritance and to ensure it. It was not always, as we oftentimes think, of somebody bringing a baby home. Oftentimes, it could have been an adult who was being adopted into the family, because it was all about inheritance. And if you were adopted into the family, that meant you were in line to receive all of the inheritance of the family, all the honors and titles that went with it. And it wasn't necessarily just children. It was oftentimes, and not unusual, for it to be an adult. Emperor Claudius adopted Nero when he was a teenager. Nero's mother was the sister to Caligula, and Claudius wanted to ensure his succession, and so he adopted Nero as his son, even though he had other children, had other sons. But because Nero was the oldest, he was the one who inherited the job of emperor of the Roman Empire. Later on, when Nero wanted to marry Claudius's daughter, his stepsister, he had to have a special act passed by the Roman Senate in order for that to be legal, because technically that was his sister since he had been adopted by Claudius. Don't you know that was a happy family? Think of the movie Ben-Hur. When Judah Ben-Hur was a slave galley, they were in a battle with the Macedonians, I believe it was, and in this sea battle, the ship that Ben-Hur was on was rammed and sank, and the consul, whose name was Quintus Arius, was on that ship. It was kind of the head ship of this armada that Rome had sent out to defeat these pirates. In the process, Ben-Hur freed the galley slaves because they had been chained to their seats so that they wouldn't run, and they were going to go down with the ship. And he also saved the consul's life. And you'll remember they're bobbing around out in the Mediterranean, and the consul thinks that the battle has been lost, and he tries to take his own life, and Ben-Hur stops him from doing so. And then when they're finally rescued, they learned that the Romans had defeated the pirates. It was a victory for the consul. He was so happy. And after they finally got back to land, he adopted Judah Ben-Hur as his son, so that Ben-Hur was to inherit all the honors, titles that the consul had for himself. So when he goes back to Judah and presents himself, he presents himself as the son of Quintus Arius. It was all about inheritance. It was all about receiving what the family had to leave you. We are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Having been adopted into the family, we are heirs and joint heirs with Christ. There's an important distinction here. If a farmer owns a spread and has four children and he dies and he leaves his four children as heirs, then the farm is divided up 25% for each of them. But if he leaves them as joint heirs, that means the whole farm belongs to any one individual child. They can claim all of it, the land, the equipment, the homes, the houses that are on it. They are owners of all of it. They are joint heirs together. So that means everything that has been given to Jesus Christ, because we are joint heirs with Christ, everything that has been given to Christ is ours because we are joint heirs with Him. All of the riches and glory of heaven will be ours as joint heirs with Christ. Paul writes to the Ephesians and he tells them in the first chapter that every spiritual blessing has been given to us by God because we're joint heirs with Christ. He tells us too in 1 Corinthians that all the wisdom that God has to give is ours because we are heirs with Christ. And in probably one of the most astounding statements, when Jesus was praying there in the garden in John 17, he prays to his Father in heaven and says, "All of the glory that you have given me, I give to them." Talking about his disciples, talking about me and you. I will spend the rest of my life trying to figure out and understand all the dynamic that means of being a joint heir with Christ. But because the Holy Spirit is in me, when we say we believe in Jesus, it means far more than thinking we believe that this man lived 2,000 years ago in Palestine. When we say we believe in Christ, it means that we don't only believe that he lived 2,000 years ago, but that he lives today. He lives with us. He lives in us. And all that Christ is ours because we are joint heirs with Christ. Can you fathom what that means? Can you come to grip in just any kind of a small way the full dynamic of what it means that everything that God is giving to Jesus Christ, He gives to us as joint heirs? Paul wrote in that fourth chapter of Philippians, talking about how he can live without and he can live with much. He can live when he's high on the mountain and he can live when he's low in the valley. He can live with a great deal of abundance and he can live and have joy with nothing. Because he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. All of the power of God that has been given to Jesus Christ is power given to us as heirs, as joint heirs. And we can live with that power in our lives today to overcome all that life might throw at us, to be able to live in such a way that our emotions and all that we are about is not tied to whether the market is up or whether the market is down, whether there's wars or peace. We can live with such power that God gives us that we can enjoy abundant life in any circumstance, at any time, or at any place. Because the same power that brought Jesus out of the tomb is power for us to be able to live our lives. And that power that brought Jesus out of the tomb is the power that will enable us to live in eternity forever with Him. We are joint heirs. We are joint heirs. If you were to get a letter today in the mail from some attorney telling you that Bill Gates or Warren Buffett has left you in their will, you would be ecstatic. You would be picking a new condo down at the beach. You would be looking at your car and thinking what you're going to do to replace it. And then you would show up at the attorney's office and find out Bill left you $500. Because you're an heir. He didn't say you're going to get all of it, but you would be an heir. We are joint heirs with Christ. No question about what is ours. No doubt of what is going to be ours. Because we are joint heirs with Christ. All of the glory, all of the power, all of the wisdom, all of the grace that has been given to Jesus Christ has been given to us to sustain and keep us today and to assure our eternity with Christ forever. Now, we ought to be thinking about that with such thrill as we would be thinking if we got that letter from an attorney telling us we were an heir of Bill Gates. It ought to so excite us that God, who has adopted us and brought us into His family through Jesus Christ, would lavish on us such blessing. God always initiates the blessing and then calls you and I to live in it. And He is calling you and I to live in the blessing of being the adopted children of God, and to understand the dynamics of all that is ours because we are joint heirs with Christ. You ought to send up fireworks this weekend just because of that. Come to an understanding of all that is yours as a child of God. Come to an understanding of all that God has provided for you in Jesus Christ. Because there is nothing in this book that you could read that has been given to Christ that isn't yours for life today and for life tomorrow. And to that we should say, thanks be to God. Amen.
Having heard God's word proclaimed, I invite you, all children of God, to stand. As together we affirm what it is we believe using the Apostles' Creed. Sisters and brothers, what do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to remain standing as we sing together hymn 739, Oh for a Closer Walk with God. Thank you.
As we gather today, we want to remember the concerns of our congregation. First off, we want to remember Marsha Quarles, who is home recovering from shoulder surgery in Birmingham, Lois Fuller, who is at Aspire Rehab, and Tony Lynn, who continues his recovery at DCH. We're grateful that Bruce Caples is home and back there with his family. And we also want to remember Stuart McGregor's father, who fell and broke his hip and now is in a rehab in Florence, Alabama. Let's remember all of these as we turn to God now in prayer. With the psalmist, we pray, I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted us out of the depths. Lord, our God, we call to you for help and you healed us. Sing the praises of the Lord, you, his faithful people. Praise his name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Hear, Lord, and be merciful to us. Lord, be our help. O God, we bless you. And you bless us again and again, making your grace known to all. You have blessed us with the fellowship of this congregation, and you have blessed us by placing us in a bountiful land that and given us riches beyond what the rest of the world has known. We pray that you will find us faithful stewards of your love and grace that you continue to give. Because of your steadfast love, we pray for all who need you, those we have mentioned by name, as well as those whose names we lift to you in silence this morning. Lord, we remember too the families of those who have died by violence in Istanbul and Bangladesh. We continue to pray for the many countries torn by war in the Middle East and beyond. We pray you will be with our nation's leaders, all of our nation's leaders, and especially the President of the United States, to guide them and give them wisdom to seek peace and justice. Guide us all as your disciples in all that we do, and teach us to pray as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue our worship as we bring God's tithes and our offerings. We're grateful for your faithfulness in giving week after week. Let's honor God now once more with our gifts.
Thank you.
Lord, we give you thanks for these gifts and all the many gifts that you give us, and pray that these would be returned to your glory. Lord, we also give thanks. We give thanks for living in a country and a freedom that we can enjoy. Yet we also pray for those places where oppression and violence rule the day, be it in this country or elsewhere. We give thanks for living in a country with great wealth and great resources, and yet we also pray for those places where people cannot seem to escape the bonds of poverty, be they in this country or elsewhere. Lord, we give thanks for living in a country where food and clean water are available. Yet we also pray for those places where food and clean water are as scarce as the desert, be it in this country or elsewhere. Lord, we give thanks for living in a country with great power. Yet we also pray for those places and for those people who seem to be powerless and who have no voice, be it in this country or elsewhere. Lord, we do give thanks for this place, for this community, for this country, and we pray that we would live a life of thanksgiving by responding in love, in grace, and in peace to all of your children, be they in this country or elsewhere. In Christ's name, amen. I invite you to remain standing as we sing our closing hymn, number 338, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies.
Thank you.
As the children of God, now go in peace. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be with you now and forevermore. Amen.